are you going? And who or what is getting you there? Have you ever had one of those moments where a whole series of events seem to collide and coalesce perfectly to lead you in a direction you had never anticipated? I had one of those moments on Wednesday night. I got home late from a session meeting and a post-session meeting with one of our ministry team of moderators. And when I walked in our front door, I was carrying my laptop and I was carrying a box that had half of a leftover sandwich from my dinner. And when I go home, I always put my laptop in this basket above the TV. So, of course, one of the first things I did was walk over to the TV on the way to the kitchen and try to put my laptop in. Except earlier in the day, I had been in a rush and I had thrown one of the books that I was reading for my sermon preparation up into the basket, and so when I put the laptop in, it didn't rest flat and it didn't sit down into the basket. And it came shooting out of the basket and hit my arm, which was good. My laptop didn't fall to the ground. But when it hit my arm, the sandwich box was in my hand. And you see, the sandwich box went down and I compensated going up, and the box flew open and the sandwich flew through the air, lettuce going everywhere, and landed on the floor. And you see, this was a bat signal to the dogs then, of course. And they jumped up from their respective corners of the house where they were sleeping and they ran to the spot like vultures. And as I tried to push the dogs away, I stepped back. And I happened to step on a toy car that the kids had left there. And you see that my feet went flying out from underneath me, and I landed on my rear end on the floor. The cute computer was amazingly okay. You see, all of these trajectories, my earlier trajectory that day of throwing a book up in the basket, the kids' trajectory with that toy car, the trajectory of the dogs' noses toward that food, even Carolyn Woodard's trajectory earlier that day when she generously asked if she could bring me a sandwich before supper. All of it had coalesced and conspired to put me on my butt that night. I remember in my high school physics class learning about inertia. Physics always fascinated me, and later in college, when I was required to take some science credits, I chose to take the physics of spaceflight. No, it wouldn't be everyone's choice. And we talked a lot in that course about inertia and motion and trajectory. And those of you who know physics, you know that everything in physics is about force. It's about the force that is imposed on an object. As the saying goes in physics, an object at rest will stay at rest, and an object in motion will stay in motion. More specifically, an object in motion will stay in motion along a straight line at a continuous speed unless it's acted upon by some outside force. Now, of course, that's not what we experience on Earth because we have this thing called gravity that affects us. But in space, or in a vacuum, objects just keep going. Well, we human beings, we're able to move through space, even on Earth with this thing called gravity. We're able to speed up and slow down or change directions because our bodies, like all living things, generate energy from taking in food and air and water and light. So our motions through life are at least somewhat directed by some level of volition. But there are also forces, unexpected forces, like falling laptops, that can change our course, even kick us on our butts. Now, as you know, despite my interest in physics and my fascination with physical motion, my career path took a very different direction. Instead of following that passion for physical motion, I followed the passion for the motion and the trajectory of human lives. Now think about where you are in life right now. Think about the career or job you have, or the one you retired from. Think about the friends or the spouse or the partners with whom you spend your life. Think about the place you live. Think about the big things you have accomplished in your life. Think about the challenges you've come through. Even think about what brought you here today to be a part of this beloved community in this space right now. Now, some of it, no doubt, came from your own energy. It came from choices you made. It came from the hard work and the dedication and the time, or the lack thereof, that you have poured into it. But I imagine, if you're honest, I imagine there are probably other forces in your life that have acted upon you. Events or people that have collided with your path. And their force has changed either the speed or the trajectory of your own. And sometimes the series of those collisions seems so unlikely that we start to wonder if all of those moving pieces that got us to this place and time, right here, right now, we start to wonder if they've been acted upon by some greater force, like a gravity for souls, pulling our whole story together. Now, sometimes we call that force good luck, and sometimes we call it misfortune or fate. But sometimes we sense something deeper and something more intentional. All right, I know after all of the Star Wars films, it seems rather cliche for me to talk about God being like the Force. But if we believe that God is about something in the world, if we believe that God is doing something new in the world, as Jesus claims God is doing, if we believe the Spirit of the living God is on the move in the world, then it seems quite reasonable that while we might not perceive God directly, we would perceive the waves of motion and those changes in trajectory and of speed that result from collisions with the divine path. As commentator Ronald Cole Turner puts it, the story of Lydia witnesses to just that. A long list of improbable events that led to Lydia's encounter with Paul. And Lydia, this character in the Bible, appears to be no stranger to improbable events. I really should have saved my Prince reference for this Sunday, because we're told very little about Lydia, but one of the things we're told is that she was a dealer in purple cloth. And apparently she was the head of her own household, or at least had a lot of influence and power over her own household. And that was something quite rare, and certainly against the social convention of the time. Now, purple cloth, you may know, was extremely rare and extremely difficult to make and very costly. And so it was worn only by the royalty and the elites. So we can deduce from that that Lydia was someone who was fairly wealthy and who ran in circles of wealth. As commentator Packer Matthews notes, there has been a lot of speculation about Lydia over the years. And one such speculation is the long-running understanding that she was a former slave. We don't know that for sure, but that's the tradition. So this successful businesswoman, possibly a former slave, she's defied all of the odds to become someone of power and influence in a world that would have worked against her at every turn. Forces have coalesced around her tenacity and around her determination and led her to this place where she is in life. And not only that, but we find out something else that's very interesting about Lydia. We find out that she's a European Gentile who has somehow found her way into the worship of the Jewish God, the Hebrew people's God. Now, certainly that was not a spiritual path that flowed against the grain, or with the grain of her culture. So as becomes apparent in the story of Lydia, when Lydia makes her way down to the river to pray to this God who has so romanced her and so moved into all of those openings of her heart, we see that the Spirit of the Living God is one of those forces, one of those trajectories that has already collided with hers and is shaping and directing her own. Turner puts it this way. There at the riverside, Lydia found the God who was finding her. Let me say that again. There at the riverside, Lydia found the God who was finding her. And Turner goes on to say, longing and grace meet here on this riverbank. The longing heart of a faithful woman is opened by the gracious impulse of a faith-giving God in an action that, like the incarnation itself, is at once fully human and fully divine. And we know that Paul's openness to the Spirit also leads him and his companions to be swept up in this story and this trajectory of Lydia's. We know that they're taken well off the course and the plan they had set for their missionary work. And you know, perhaps God knew that it would take a vision of a man from Macedonia asking for help to get Paul and his companions to change directions so drastically. But of course, God didn't actually intend for their path to intersect with a man's. Instead, God intended for their path to collide with this powerful woman, Lydia, intended that she might overhear the gospel of the good news of the living Christ, and that all of that longing inside of her might finally find a home. And we know that not only does Paul's trajectory shape hers, but Lydia's trajectory radically shapes Paul's as well. Remember who Paul is? Paul is that very faithful Jewish man to the core. He is the one who persecuted Christians because he so loved God and thought that Christians were moving in opposition to God. And Paul is also the one who, on that road to Damascus, is so powerfully and transformatively intercepted by Jesus that his life does a 180, and he becomes a missionary and an evangelist, and a bearer of this story that he tried so hard to silence. Now, as a very faithful Jewish man who would probably never have broken social, religious, or cultural convention to speak to a woman, much less a Gentile woman and a former slave, the fact that Paul finds himself not only speaking to Lydia, but baptizing her and staying in her home, an unclean Gentile home, and starting a house church there, is quite remarkable. And remember, this church will become the church at Philippi. It will become one of the few churches that Paul, when he's writing to all the churches he's founded, doesn't have to write a bunch of scolding words or words to correct their behavior, because this church got it. They embody the love of Christ. Yeah. knows that in Paul's letter to another church he would found, the Galatian church, he shares with them words of the baptismal formula that was used by the very early followers of the Jesus way. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And you see, Matthew, she imagines how powerful these words must have been when Paul set them down there by the riverside as he was baptizing Lydia. Lydia, this woman who had already broken all of those molds and defied all of those binaries, Jew and Greek, slave and free, the roles of male and female. But what I wonder if those words weren't spoken for the very first time at Lydia's baptism. I wonder if Paul's collision with Lydia's story and the spontaneous inbreaking of the Spirit in that moment of baptizing her had made him realize that this message, these words, were the truth that God was speaking through Lydia's story. And I wonder if then, with each community that Paul founded, he shared those words as words of good news to them. You know, it's really quite remarkable that we get to hear Lydia's story so many years later. It's remarkable that it was handed down to us through so many years, when so many women in our biblical narrative remain these nameless shadows in the background. Their stories silenced, their stories left untold or deemed not important enough to be told. Perhaps it's only because she was a dealer in purple cloth, an elite, the head of a household, that her story was shared. But it's made its way to us, this rare story of a named woman that is absolutely stunning in its brevity and powerful nonetheless. Maya Angelou once said, "There is no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside of you." And so I ask you to ponder, what part of your own story has been silenced or left untold? What stories in our community have been silenced or left untold? Because you see, our story is wrapped up in God's story. And I believe it causes God some agony when the story of our collisions with the divine path are left untold. So I will ask you the same question I asked at the very beginning of the sermon. Where are you going? And who or what is moving you there? And I'll add to that, who or what are you moving? And if your story was told in its fullness, what piece of God's truth might be revealed in you as it was in Lydia? You know, this morning we are blessed to have Megan Holmes here with us from FAST, and we're going to have a time of discussion after church. And one of the things that we do through that ministry is to try to change the trajectory of our community. We try to line ourselves up with the divine path we see of justice for our community, and to move our officials and move our leaders and our entire community through that. And I am immensely proud of this church and the ways that you showed up to the Nehemiah Action and the ways you show up to meetings with officials and all of you who are network members who brought your community. So I want to say thanks be to God. God for our story, and thanks be to God for Lydia's story, who was carried down to us through so many ages. Thanks be to God for all of those stories where the Spirit has intercepted the longing